بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. معكم الدكتور إبراهيم أبو سيف، أستاذ طب الأطفال بيدياتريكس and neonatology in Shamsi University. First of all, we have to discuss today birth injuries and some neonatal neurological problems. Our session will be divided into three parts. Part one, birth injuries. Part two, hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy. Part 3, neonatal convulsion. Birth injuries. Our intended learning outcome by the end of this lecture, you should be able to define and identify the significance of birth injury, to identify the risk factors for birth injuries, to identify the clinical picture and management of different head injuries, neck and shoulder injuries, and intra-abdominal injuries. First of all, we have to know the risk factors for birth injuries to predict that for early intervention. Number one, prematurity, very low birth weight and extremely preterm baby, primary parity, mean primary gravida, cephalopelvic disproportion, dystochia, shoulder dystochia, prolonging or rapid labor out of expected for the case, oligohydramnios, abnormal fetal presentation, macrosomia, like infant of diabetic mothers, fetal anomalies, forceps or vacuum extraction, as pictured. Number one, head injury. This figure shows the sites for different types of head injury. Number one, cabled succedaneum. Number two, cephal hematoma. Number three, subclavian hemorrhage. Number four and five, intracranial hemorrhage, extradural and other types. Number one, cabot succedaneum. This is the most frequent observed lesion and most benign, vaguely demarcated area of edema over the portion of the scalp that was the presenting part during vertex delivery. Clinical manifestation: soft swelling, usually few millimeter thickness, may be associated with overlying BTK purpura ecchymosis, poorly defined margins, may extend across the midline of the skull and across suture lines. Usually resolves spontaneously within days and no need for management. Number two, cephal hematoma. Subperiosteal collection of blood overlying the cranial bone. Instance about 2.5% of lip purses caused during labor by rupture of blood vessels that traverse from skull to periosteum. Clinical manifestations: bleeding limited to suture line, may not be apparent for a few hours after birth, may be associated with skull fractures, about 10% of cases, take longer time, about 6 to 12 weeks, occasionally residual calcification occurs. Management: usually no need for management if non-complicated case, but contraindicated incision or aspiration. Take care. Blood transfusion may be needed if there is marked blood loss. Phototherapy if there is neonatal jaundice developed due to hemolysis of that blood collection. Associated fracture, sometime if linear fracture follow-up only is sufficient. Depressed fracture, immediate neurological consultation is needed. Number three, subglial hemorrhage. A collection of blood in the soft tissue space between glia of the neurosis and periosteum of the skull. The same etiology, but have to be suspected coagulopathy, like vitamin K deficiency, in shoulder dystocia, or prematurity, more common. Intracranial hemorrhage, this is the most serious lesion, occur in about 20 up to 40% of infants with birth weight under 1.5 kg. It is less common among more mature newborn. Bleeding can occur in epidural or subdural subarachnoid space, parenchymal, intracerebral or cerebellar, intraventricular. Clinical presentation, up to 50% of cases may be silent, but if there is manifestation, you have to predict the problem by shock, pallor, respiratory distress, DIC, jaundice, signs of neurological dysfunction, bulging anterior fontanelle, hypotonia, seizures, temperature instability, up to apnea. Diagnosis is confirmed by imaging, by cranial ultrasound, CT scan, MRI. Management: avoid unnecessary manipulation of the infant, especially preterm babies. Administer volume expander slowly, like albumin, plasma, and blood. Vitamin K and coagulation defect. Treat seizures and hyperpleuropneemia if present. Part 2, injuries of the neck and shoulder, like fractured skull, fractured clavicle, brachial plexus injury, phrenic nerve paralysis, sternomastoid muscle injury. Fractured clavicle, usually presented by decreased movement of the ipsilateral arm, pain on movement, tenderness, absent or weak motor in the affected side, resolved spontaneously with support within 7 to 14 days. X-ray confirms diagnosis. More serious is brachial plexus injury. Paralysis of the muscles of the upper extremity due to mechanical trauma of the spinal root of the brachial plexus from C5 to T1 roots during birth may be compressed only or complete avulsion of the root. Etiology: excessive traction of head, neck, arm during birth. We have three main forms of the brachial plexus injury: ERBS, palsy, C5, 6, occasionally C7 root. This is the most common lesion: clombix, lower arm paralysis of the plexus, C7, C8, T1 root, or entire paralysis of the arm, like avulsion. Herpes palsy usually occur a large asphyxiated baby, affected arm is held like the picture, extended, adducted, internally rotated, motor reflex absent, biceps radial reflex on the affected side also affected, grasp reflex is intact, signs of respiratory distress if there is associated phrenic nerve root injury. Management: partial immobilization of the affected arm 1 to 2 weeks, gentle massage and physiotherapy up to 3 months after 2 weeks. If no improvement, neurological consultation may be needed. Clombix paralysis involves the entire muscles of the hand and long flexor of the wrist and finger. Paralysis of the hand occur with absent grasp reflex. Intact deep tendon reflexes. There may be dependent edema, cyanosis of the hand, trophic changes of the fingernails, later on atrophy of the intrinsic muscles of the hand. Usually, ipsilateral Hoebner syndrome may occur. Phrenic nerve paralysis. Most injuries are unilateral and are associated with ipsilateral upper brachial plexus injury, most commonly due to difficult breech injury. Breech delivery. Clinical manifestation. Initially, recurrent episodes of cyanosis, irregular and labored, difficult respiration. Breathing almost completely thoracic. Diminished breath sounds over the affected side. Tachypnea, weak cry, apnea. In severe cases. This is X-ray. Chest showing elevated cavula of the affected side. Treatment, mostly non-specific medical treatment, positioning of involved side, supplemental oxygen, IV fluid, gavage feeding, rile feeding, antibiotics if pneumonia occur. Mechanical ventilation may be necessary. Diaphragm application if no improvement after 1 month. Lastly, liver, spleen, adrenal gland injury, abdominal injury. Clinical manifestation are in the form of MS in the left upper quadrant in splenic injury. Adrenal hemorrhage, adrenal insufficiency in the form of poor feeding, vomiting, diarrhea, dehydration, irritability, hypoglycemia shock. This occurs if there is bilateral adrenal hemorrhage. Investigations, abdominal ultrasound, adrenal function, CT scan and MRI can be ordered. Management, immediate blood transfusion, laparotomy and evacuation of the hematoma and repair of any laceration may be needed. Adrenal insufficiency may require steroids. We will discuss inshallah remaining two parts, hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy and neonatal seizure in part 2 and part 3. Please be ready with your question in the next face-to-face session. Thank you.